Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Deloitte's 17th Lincoln Learn session for 2015. My name is Eugene O'Keefe from the tax group here at Deloitte in Dublin, Ireland. And for today's session, we're going to provide a tax update on various topical issues which could impact business across the EU. We have speakers from Luxembourg and Ireland. Next slide, please. The objective of today's Lincoln Learn session is to cover, as I said, a number of tax issues. I myself, Eugene O'Keefe, will cover the latest FATCA developments, and my colleague at Deloitte here in Dublin, Karen Devine, will cover what's coming down the track from the OECD, which is the Common Reporting Standard, and which is really FATCA Part 2, and similar to FATCA, it's an exchange of information provisions, which is going to be highly relevant from 2016 onwards. From our Luxembourg office, Manuela Abreu will cover some latest developments in capital gains tax, particularly around the whole area of provisioning, risks, monitoring, etc., and some rule changes as well. Also from our Luxembourg office, Irene Iguil will cover some transfer pricing implications for particularly management companies as we're in the IM space. In terms of update on VAT and particularly developments in relation to EU case law, Richard McDade from the Dublin office here will provide an update. And finally, in view of the emerging BEPS provisions, which we expect next week, we'll have some comment on the expected proposals, and that will be covered by Manuela. Today's session will last approximately 1 hour. Next slide, please. Firstly, FATCA. The first reporting deadline in most, if not all, tax jurisdictions has now passed, and a lot of lessons have been learned at every level. So looking into preparing for reporting next year, there are a few key developments in Ireland which should be of interest to you, and I suppose lessons from Ireland are probably also lessons that are relevant to other jurisdictions. Next slide, please. Lessons learned, I suppose. Firstly, nil returns. It's interesting to note that most of the returns filed by the Irish Revenue, most of the returns filed by Irish financial institutions seem to have been nil returns. But this may beg the question as to whether the IRS are getting all the information they expected to obtain from the introduction of FATCA. That said, there's no indication from Revenue that nil returns will be abolished in the future. The position is slightly different, certainly in the UK, but from an Irish perspective, nil returns are something that are going to be obligatory going forward. FATCA compliance program. It's interesting to note that the Irish Revenue have in recent weeks commenced work on their FATCA compliance program. While they've thankfully indicated a soft landing for year one, it's interesting to note that they have said that they will, in the coming weeks, be carrying out matching exercises between IRS GINs and FATCA returns, as they felt that a return should have been filed for each GIN obtained. There's been no indication to date as to what follow-up, if any, there will be, or indeed the format of such follow-ups, where returns are found to be incorrect, incomplete, or indeed outstanding. And suffice to say, there are stringent penalties in the Irish domestic legislation for failure to file returns. So it's interesting to see that Revenue are going to be proactive in terms of the overall FATCA compliance. Finally, just around simplified nil FATCA reporting, as I mentioned earlier, there is going to be an obligation to continue making nil returns. And while nil FATCA reporting was abolished in the UK prior to the first reporting deadline, Irish Revenue still saw taxpayers falling within the scope of FATCA to file nil FATCA returns. The reporting process for nil FATCA returns was complicated and resulted in many taxpayers having to engage service providers to prepare such returns. While the obligations to file nil FATCA returns will remain, the Irish Revenue have confirmed that the process will be simplified for 2016 calendar year. It's anticipated under the simplified procedures for nil reporting, FATCA filers will need to tick a box on the ROS facility, which indicates that they're making a nil FATCA filing in order to comply with their obligations. This facility is also expected to be available for reporting under the Common Reporting Standard. Next slide, please. Further to the introduction of FATCA, the OECD has released their Common Reporting Standard, which is more commonly known as CRS. My colleague Karen Devine will now take you through what CRS is and what it means. Next slide, please.
In simple terms, FATCA-like reporting, CRS is FATCA-like reporting, which has been applied to account holders in a number of tax jurisdictions outside the US. FATCA will remain in place for all US account holders. CRS is the new single global standard on automatic exchange of information, which is the result of a drive by the G20 nations to develop a global standard for the automatic exchange of financial account information. This is in an effort to address perceived offshore tax evasion. What is likely obvious from its close links with FATCA is that CRS was developed by the OECD based on existing FATCA legislation. The close correlation was made by the OECD in an effort to maximize efficiency and reduce costs for financial institutions in implementing the standard locally. While closely related, there are, however, some distinct differences between the two systems. This is driven to a large extent by the multilateral nature of CRS when compared to FATCA. There are also US-specific features of FATCA, such as reporting on the basis of citizenship as well as tax residence, which are not present in CRS. We will look at these in detail in a few minutes. So what does CRS actually oblige you to do? CRS obliges all reporting financial institutions to carry out certain due diligence processes for identifying reportable accounts, and then it sets out the process for reporting those reportable accounts to the tax authorities of other countries signed up to the standard. Non-reporting financial institutions have no obligation, but they must be clear as to their CRS classification for reporting to other financial reporting institutions which are signed up and who may be in turn required to report this information to revenue under the CRS. Over 90 jurisdictions have committed to the exchanging information under CRS, with a group of over 60 countries, including Ireland, having committed to early adoption. From the 1st of January 2016, reporting financial institutions in Ireland will need to implement updated onboarding standards for new financial institutions in Ireland, and we need to update the standards for individual entity account holders. It is intended that the first reporting under CRS in Ireland will be in June 2017, and that information will be onward reported by revenue to other tax authorities in September 2017. So on this slide, you can see some of the information that is currently released on CRS to date. There's a lot of information available. Firstly, the OECD has issued the standard, including a standard schema, which not only sets out who must report, but also what must be reported and the format of what should be reported. A local schema for Ireland is to be developed, but this has not yet been released. In addition to the standard and the standard schema, the OECD has issued a CRS handbook, which is more of a practical guide to CRS and its implementation. The CRS handbook contains a number of practical examples showing how the guidance is to be interpreted and applied. It is intended that this handbook will be a living document which will be constantly updated by the OECD to take account of new information. The CRS handbook has been further supplemented by FAQs issued by both the OECD and Irish Revenue. While the UK has issued further guidance in respect to CRS, at this time Revenue has no intention to issue similar guidance, and instead they intend to deal with the practical interpretation issue on CRS through a series of published FAQs. Given the various delays that we experienced when updating FATCA guidance, this is helpful. Although there are legislative provisions written in law to allow Irish Revenue to report financial information as stipulated in the standard, the statutory instrument dealing with the way in which the standard will be implemented in Ireland has yet to be released. Draft CRS regulations have been made available and were open for comment in recent weeks. It is expected that these regulations will be signed and released before January 2017. SI16 will certainly be a dynamic period in terms of preparing for and reporting under CRS. Many financial institutions will face operational challenges, both in classifying account holders and gathering and reporting their information. It is also important that they keep up to date with constant changes in CRS. The difficulties faced, however, may unfortunately not be balanced by the significant compliance benefit. Let's take a closer look now at CRS and some of the main items that we need to be aware of in the run-up to 2017. Next slide, please. do a look at the entity classifications under CRS. As you probably notice, the entity classifications under CRS are broadly aligned to those under FACA and includes custodial institutions, depository institutions, investment entities, and specified insurance companies. So there's no major surprises there. However, it's important to be aware that the definition of some of the entity classifications is slightly different under CRS, including that for investment entity and that for specified insurance company. While you would expect that those entities which have a reporting obligation for FACA purposes would have a similar obligation under CRS, it is important that these entities which did not have a reporting obligation under FACA do consider if they have such an obligation under CRS. Entities with no obligations under CRS will be considered, as with FACA, to be non-financial entities for CRS purposes. Again, like FACA, they will be classified as either active or passive for CRS purposes. And as with FACA, there is specific guidance issued by the CRS to determine how this is the case. Next slide. Secondly, you will note that there has been an increase in the reporting under CRS when it's compared to FACA. Where previously, only account information in respect of US account holders was reportable under FACA regulations, under CRS, account information in respect of account holders in all participating jurisdictions is reportable. If you take the example on the slide, where an Irish reporting financial institution has both German and US account holders, prior to the introduction of CRS, the Irish reporting financial institution only had an obligation to report in respect of US account holders. However, under CRS, information on the German account holders and the US account holders will now be reportable. Irish Revenue will then onward report this information to the German tax authorities and the IRS. Next slide. Another key difference between FACA and CRS is the definition of investment entity for FACA purposes. This has changed under CRS. Under the new definition of investment entity, professionally managed entities such as funds which are based in non-participating jurisdictions will now be classified as passive non-financial entities rather than financial institutions. This will mean that where such funds hold accounts in reportable financial institutions, that reportable institution will be required to look through the fund to find controlling persons in each case in order to determine what the tax jurisdictions and the relevant account information is reportable. This is certainly a challenge for large funds. The difference is probably best and easily explained by an example. Assume we are a reporting financial institution for CRS purposes, and our account holder is a professionally managed US fund, which is considered to be an investment entity for CRS purposes. The first box in the slide sets out what would report by us as a reportable financial institution for CRS purposes. In this situation, as Ireland has no automatic exchange agreement with the US for CRS purposes, the US is considered to be a non-participating jurisdiction. Therefore, we would treat the fund as a passive non-financial entity, meaning we are obliged to look through the fund to identify the ultimate controlling persons, which in this case are French and Italian individuals. In this case, the information on those individuals will be reportable to Revenue, and Revenue will onward report this information. If, however, instead of having a US fund, our fund was actually French, France is a participating institution for CRS purposes, and the controlling persons behind that fund would not be reportable. I will now hand you back to Eugene, who will take you through some of the other key differences and considerations. Next slide.
Thank you, Karen. I'm just looking at other key differences between CRS and FATCA. FATCA and CRS include some other key differences between FACA and CRS include the absence of withholding tax obligations where CRS rules are not complied with. For FACA, where entities were not compliant, tax could be withheld on their payments. While this is slightly irrelevant for IGA countries for FACA purposes, meaning that this withholding did not apply, it still remains a key difference between two reporting requirements. It still remains that companies are encouraged to comply with the CRS because non-compliance with the standard would mean that they are not compliant with local tax rules, which could have reputational impact on them in carrying out their business both locally and internationally. And of course, local penalties could also apply if CRS rules are not complied with. So although no withholding under CRS, it's very important that compliance is adhered to. Another key difference is that identifying which account holders are reportable under CRS is a residence-only based test, as opposed to the citizenship and residency-based tests which exist for FATCA. Thankfully, the CRS commentary provided by the OECD sets out in detail as to how the residency of an account holder is to be determined. Certain categories of non-reporting financial institutions have also been removed completely from CRS. This, as you would expect, may result in a greater number of entities having CRS registration and reporting requirements. Reporting financial institutions should therefore consider whether any group entities previously with limited obligations due to various exemptions now fall substantially within the scope of CRS such that they need to report to the tax authorities for CRS purposes. Finally, the threshold for reporting pre-existing individual and entity accounts have either been lowered or completely removed depending upon the type of entity and the nature of the account holder. This means that accounts which are not reportable for FATCA purposes may now be reportable for CRS purposes. There are, of course, a number of other differences between FATCA and CRS, mainly in respect to what is reportable under each, but this should have given you a high-level idea of the main high-level points which are relevant now. Other key considerations should be explored and built into your internally developed CRS preparation plan. In addition to the key differences between FATCA and CRS I've outlined, there are also a number of other key considerations entities should be aware of in respect of the implementation of CRS, including what the format of the self-certification under CRS will be. Unlike for FATCA, the US forms W-8 and W-9 will not capture all of the required information for CRS because of the differences including legal classifications under CRS which do not exist under FATCA. It is expected that standard self-certifications will be made available by the OECD and certainly various industry groups in the near future, and that those, I suppose, model self-certification forms should be available shortly. As with FATCA, tax authorities have confirmed that they are open to the form of self-certification used by reporting financial institutions under CRS, so long as such forms capture all of the relevant information required. As with FATCA, the Irish funds industry are in the process of putting in place a sample CRS self-certification form, and that self-certification form is likely to be used by reporting financial institutions under CRS, as was the case for FATCA. So what is next? What should entities be doing now? Next slide, please. In terms of next steps for CRS, the first thing such each entity should be doing is determining whether it is, in fact, a reporting financial institution for CRS purposes. Where you are considered to be a reporting financial institution for FATCA purposes, a number of next steps should have already begun, and if not, should be started as soon as possible. At a basic level, the project team should be established and tasked with carrying out a CRS impact assessment and how the collection of data for reporting and indeed the actual reporting of that data will be managed. This should be documented in the form of a strategic plan. Developing and realizing this strategic plan may require additional assistance from outside service providers. However, it is important to note that, as with FATCA, the use of outside service providers in managing your CRS reporting obligations does not remove the obligation to be CRS compliant from the entity itself. It's still solely the responsibility of the entity itself to ensure it is fully CRS compliant. Once a sufficient team is in place, the team should identify the scope, the in-scope financial accounts which will need to be reported on. This will require developing and confirming the entity's approach to account holder due diligence, including the form of self-certification which will be provided to account holders and whether it captures all the relevant information. Following the development of the CRS strategic plan and the account holder's due diligence process, the team should consider how they will track CRS implementation across multiple jurisdictions and changes in relation to CRS in those multiple jurisdictions. An important element of CRS preparation is the assessment of the impact of potential changes required in internal policies and procedures to facilitate data collection for CRS purposes. Care must be taken to ensure that systems are capable of facilitating the data collection and reporting requirements of each participating jurisdiction. Once the systems have been updated sufficiently and the required amendments to onboarding for new clients, in addition to internal due diligence for existing clients, have been completed, it's important that the achievement of CRS compliance is clearly documented. As you can see, there are multiple considerations when seeking to be compliant with CRS. I hope this gives you a clear summary as to what CRS is and the information that is available and what you need to do next. And I'll pass you over to my colleague in Luxembourg, Manuela, who will speak you through some capital gains tax developments. Next slide, please.
Thank you very much, Eugene. So on capital gains, what is the idea? What is the reasoning behind the monitoring of tax risks? Well, the idea is that all financial institutions, whether global banks, management companies, custodian banks, asset managers, funds or brokers, will at some stage buy, hold, manage, or sell capital market securities, such as shares or bonds, or enter into derivatives, either on their account or on behalf of clients. These securities can be issued in many countries, each of which imposes its own local taxation, which can be complicated and subject to change. Tax authorities are increasing their scrutiny of operational compliance with securities transactions, and the best example being the Indian tax authorities, which we will talk about in the next slide, and imposing new taxes in this space. In risk management terms, the cost of mismanaging operational taxes can be very high. Taxes are imposed on gross flows and transaction values rather than spreads of net profits. The amounts can, if not properly managed, be large and significantly reduce any potential profit from a transaction. Understanding and managing the operational tax risk and allocating responsibility for this role are essential risk management and compliance tasks within an organization and with its providers. Well, naturally, talking about managing tax risks, we talk about capital gains taxation. Even more than dividend or interest income, nowadays the spotlight is upon the tax treatment of realized and unrealized capital gains. Over the next slides, we will give you an overview of what we have seen this last year and what we have been discussing with our clients. When we look at the world map, what do we see? We see a gigantic patchwork of tax legislations, tax regulations, and guidelines. Depending on the political color of a government or the need to increase public revenues, countries introduce or maintain in their tax frameworks rules which depend upon income obtained or realized by non-resident investors when investing locally. An easy way of generating public revenue is to levy taxes on dividend, interest, or capital gains. This means that investing locally means understanding how the foreign investors will be subject to taxes, through withholding taxes or through tax returns, on which frequency, upon distribution, every 3 months, yearly, etc. It means understanding any local exemptions and the conditions to benefiting from them, and also having an understanding of local accounting rules. This point is particularly important for the discussion of accruing or not for capital gains taxes. Our experience, both in Luxembourg and in Ireland, has helped us creating a heat map, which is constantly updated and which takes into account several criteria, such as the existence of tax rules applicable to non-resident investors, the complexity of those rules, how those rules are applied, and what is the tax sensitivity of the local tax authorities towards investments done by foreign investors. In this slide, we see some examples of countries which, for one reason or another, have been rated as being at a high tax risk. And this is the case for China, Bangladesh, India, Mexico, Venezuela, Pakistan, and etc. Now, over these last 12 months, we have been talking to our clients about several investment countries, but there are a couple which clearly stood out in 2014 and 2015, which is China and India. I will now talk about India in this slide, and then the next one I'll talk about India. China has been the subject of discussion in the investment management industry for a long time. The question being, how are capital gains tax in India from the holding of A, B, and H shares? Well, 2014 and 2015 brought the much sought clarification. On 14th November 2014, the Chinese tax authorities have issued two circulars to the market, bringing clarity over the capital gains realized on A shares. We now know that capital gains realized on A shares are exempt as from the 17th November 2014, but subject to taxes up until that date. There weren't any circulars issued in 2014 or up until this date relating to the taxation of B and H shares. But it's also now common understanding that the Chinese authorities do not have the intention to tax gains from these investments, which does not mean that going forward they will not change their minds on this point. 2015 was also the year of the Chinese tax obligations for all the QFII entities that held and realized capital gains on H shares until the 17th of November 2014. Basically, both the Beijing and the Shanghai tax authorities have introduced procedures for the QFIIs to declare, report, and settle the capital gains due. The 30th of September, meaning yesterday, was the due date in Beijing for the tax settlement and in Shanghai for the tax reporting of the capital gains. The Beijing authorities have admitted the difficulty they are facing in handling all the tax reports and requests for exemption under applicable double tax treaties, and have informed the market that they will extend the 30th of September deadline to the end of 2015. Now on India. The big news about India this year was not in relation to the taxation rules, because these are settled for a while now. Basically, for our clients, what is important to know is that India levies a capital gains tax on the sale of short-term gains. Several rates apply, and there is an absolute need for the appointment of a tax agent. As I was saying, the big news related to the minimum alternate tax, commonly known as the MAT. This is also now settled in the best possible way for the non-resident investors, but for many months we have discussed the MAT with our clients, both in Luxembourg and in Ireland. So what is the MAT? Well, the MAT is a tax levied at 18.5% of a company's book profits, and was introduced to ensure that domestic Indian companies that benefited from exemptions and incentives would still pay a minimum amount of tax in India. The news was that the finance minister in its 2015-2016 budget proposed abolishing MAT on foreign companies effective as April 1st. But the tax authorities interpret the change to mean that foreign companies owed MAT for previous year's profits. So you can imagine that over 2015, the Indian authorities issued a series of retroactive tax assessments to FIIs and FPIs, shaking the investors' confidence in India. Before the summertime, the Indian government, in light of all the pressure by the investors, decided to appoint a specific committee to analyze the technical grounds of the MAT. The report of the committee was issued in August, clearly suggesting that the MAT is not to be applied to non-resident investors. On the 1st September 2015, the Indian government accepted the report of the Shah Committee, which had recommended that a minimum alternate tax should not be applicable to foreign institutional investors or foreign portfolio investors, even for the period before 1st of April 2015. And these are welcome news by all the market. So how are all these changes being perceived by the investment management industry? Clearly, there is a growing awareness that this is an extremely risky area, which requests a close monitoring and a clear engagement from the players. In Luxembourg, clients are becoming more and more familiarized with the discussions around tax provisions and are more committed to understanding the technical issues behind it. In Ireland, this discussion has been in the table for some years now, with the industry clearly understanding the importance of a close monitoring of the capital gains taxation issues and taking decisions on whether to provision or not for these taxes. In terms of how we've been assisting our clients, what we can say is that we've been providing a review of the countries of investments to identify in which high-risk countries the funds are investing. We've been checking the compliance of the funds with the local tax requirements on capital gains taxation, and we've been coordinating with our local offices to ensure the local tax compliance of the fund. And with this, I resume my section on capital gains. I will now leave the floor to Irene Aquili, that will take you through the news on how management companies are impacted by the transfer pricing rules.
Thank you, Manuela. So as far as transfer pricing is concerned, the first thing is that transfer pricing rules are based on the arm's length principle as set for in the Article 9 of the OECD Model Tax Convention, according to which a transaction between related parties have to be concluded at the same condition that would have been set between unrelated parties. Therefore, the main aim of the arm's length principle is to guarantee that intercompany transactions do not result in the shift of taxable bases between related companies that are residents in different states. In the context of the investment management industry, the concrete application of the arm's length principle has to take into consideration the specificities of the industries, as the type of remuneration that mainly consists in management fees and other type of fees, and the high level of interrelation between the management company and its related entities. Over the next slides, we will give you an overview of the main transfer pricing implication for management companies. As shown in the slide, the management companies is in charge of different activities with respect to the management of the funds. Among the activities that a management companies have to perform, we can find portfolio management activity, distribution, fund administration, risk management, and all the activities connected to the supervision and compliance of the funds. Instead of carrying out all the mentioned activities directly, the management company can delegate some activities to a third party or to a related party. In the case that some activities are delegated to a related party, transfer pricing implications have to be taken into consideration. In such a case, indeed, a remuneration has to be recognized to the related party for the performed activity, and in practice, the remuneration recognized by the management company to the related party usually consists in the retrocession of a portion of the management fees that the management company receives from the funds. Therefore, in such a scenario, from a transfer pricing perspective, it should be determined which portion of management fees has to be retroceded by the management company to the related entity in order to comply with the arm's length principle. Being both Luxembourg and Ireland OECD countries, the main reference to carry out the transfer pricing analysis are the OECD transfer pricing guidelines for multinational enterprises. According to the OECD guidelines, the transfer pricing analysis and the selection of the most appropriate method have to be based on the functional and risk profile of the entities involved, since in the transaction between independent parties, compensation usually reflects the function that each party performs, taking into consideration asset used and risk assumed. As far as investment management industries is concerned, the functional analysis would mainly consist in the analysis of which function have to be delegated by the management company, how the risk, as for example the foreign exchange risk, the liquidity risk and the retention risk, are allocated between the management company and the related party, and which are the assets at disposal of the management company and at disposal of the relating entity, taking into consideration that in the investment management industry, assets are mainly represented by full-time employees. According to our experience, in the transfer pricing analysis on Luxembourg management companies, the contribution profit split method often results the most appropriate method because the level of interrelation between parties is very high and both parties are jointly contributing to the transaction. In order to apply the contribution profit split method, the relative value of each party contribution is evaluated in order to split the transaction's profit between the parties. As far as Ireland is concerned, the selection of the appropriate transfer pricing method is much more depending on the type and number of functions delegated, the risk assumed, and the asset use. As example, in the case that the management company is delegating almost all the functions, the management company should be entitled only to a routine remuneration for bearing a fiduciary risk. Anyway, in the case that the management company is performing additional functions, a different approach as the profit split method may be applied. Transfer pricing is a hot topic for tax authorities and tax regulators, and significant changes will occur in the next years. As main future trends, we identify the impact of Action 13 of the BEST project and the increased focus of tax authorities on transfer pricing. As far as the BEPS project is concerned, Action 13 would introduce the country-by-country report that would highlight the level of taxable profit and the level of tax in due for each country in which the group operates. The country-by-country report will, on one side, increase the transfer pricing compliance burden for companies, and on the other side, it will represent a useful instrument for tax authority verifying the transfer pricing policy of a multinational group. Indeed, tax authorities are increasing both their interest and their expertise on transfer pricing, and this trend is evident both in Luxembourg and in Ireland. With specific reference to Ireland, over the last years, the Irish revenues increased their internal resources to deal with transfer pricing matters, so that they currently dispose of a number of experienced profiles from practice. This trend is leading also to the increase of transfer pricing audits that are now taking place in Ireland. In this complex environment, we usually assist the management company to draft and or review the transfer pricing policies, also to determine the portion of management fees to be kept at the level of the Luxembourg or Irish management companies, and finally to prepare an appropriate transfer pricing report to be prepared to document the transfer pricing policy that applies in case of demand by the local tax authorities. So now I'm happy to leave the floor to our colleague Richard from Ireland in order to talk about VAT for management companies.
Thank you. So just to recap, the VAT exemption for investment managers applies to the management of special investment funds as defined by member states. So there's two elements to the VAT exemption. Sorry, the first slide. First slide. Thank you. So there's two elements to the VAT exemption. First, the services provided must constitute management. And second, the recipient entity must constitute a special investment fund. So we'll just look at these two concepts in reverse order. Next slide. So first of all, what is a special investment fund? Well, Firstly, we need to figure out whether a fund is a taxable person for VAT purposes. And in Bank Brussels Lambert, the European Court held that transactions carried out by SICAVs consist in the collective investment in transferable securities of capital raised from the public, with the capital provided by subscribers when they purchased shares. SICAVs assemble and manage portfolios consisting of transferable securities. Such an activity, the court said, aims to produce income on a continuing basis and so constitutes an economic activity for VAT purposes. So accordingly, SICAVs are taxable persons within the meaning of EU VAT law. And this taxable person status is extended to all similar investment undertakings. So we know that a special investment fund is a taxable person, but the definition is management of special investment funds as defined by member states. So is it the management or is it the special investment fund over which the member state has the discretion to determine or define? In Abbey National, the court held that the term discretion within European VAT law permitted member states to determine what constitutes a special investment fund and not what falls within the term management. So applying BBL, if the member state determines that a specific investment undertaking constitutes a special investment fund, that fund is also likely to be a taxable person for VAT purposes. But what actually is a special investment fund? In Deutsche Bank, applying Abbey National, the court held that European VAT law, that the exemption covered undertakings for collective investment in transferable securities, the sole object of which is the collective investment in transferable securities and or in other liquid financial assets, of capital raised from the public, which operate on the principle of risk spreading, and the units of which are, at the request of the holders, repurchased or redeemed directly or indirectly out of those undertakings' assets. The court held that such undertakings involved joint funds, in which many investments are pooled and spread over a range of securities which can be managed effectively in order to optimize results, and in which individual investments may be relatively modest. Such funds manage their investments in their own name and on their own behalf, while each investor owns a share of the fund but not the fund's investments as such. So in Deutsche Bank, the services supplied concerned broadly the assets of a single person of relatively high overall value. The portfolio manager bought and sold investments in the name of and on behalf of the client investor. So consequently, the court held that the portfolio managed by Deutsche Bank did not satisfy the criteria to be regarded as a special investment fund within VAT law, and therefore the portfolio management services provided by Deutsche Bank did not correspond to the concept of management of special investment funds within VAT law. Accordingly, Deutsche Bank's management services were liable to VAT. So over Abbey National, member states have the discretion to determine what constitutes a special investment fund, but are there any limitations to the exercise of such discretion? Well, JP Morgan Fleming, in the UK, VAT exemption applied to open-ended funds constituted under trust law and investment companies constituted under statute, open-ended investment companies. It did not extend to closed-ended funds such as investment trust companies. The European Court held that the power to define an investment structure that qualifies to be treated as a special investment fund should be, one, exercised subject to the objectives pursued by VAT law, which the court held to be to facilitate investment in securities for investors through investment undertakings, but also, number two, but also guaranteeing the principle of fiscal neutrality from the point of view of the levying of VAT on the management of special investment funds, which are in competition with other investment funds, the management of which was not exempt. So in JP Morgan, the court held that a closed-ended fund, because it was in competition with an open-ended fund, should also be regarded as a special investment fund. So we need to be aware of the objectives of the VAT directive, be aware of competition issues, and not discriminate against competing funds. In the Wheels Common Investment Fund case, the court was asked, applying these principles, whether a defined benefit scheme, a pooling vehicle for assets of a number of the underlying Ford Group pension schemes,
if a defined benefit scheme could be treated as equivalent to a special investment fund, given that the members' and the employer's contributions were pooled in order to generate a return from a spread of investments, and that a defined benefit fund was similar to and in competition with other collective investment vehicles, the management of which was that exempt. But the court said no, for three reasons. First of all, the court said, unlike special investment funds, occupational pension schemes are not open to the public. The members of the defined pension scheme did not bear any of the investment risks. Their entitlement to a pension depends on factors like final salary or years in service, not on the value of the scheme assets or the performance of the investments. And although the employer did bear the investment risk, it is not in a comparable position to an investor in a special investment fund. It pays contributions into the pension fund to comply with its legal obligations to its employees. So while Wheels was specifically about the management of defined benefit pension funds, the court found that a fund holding the assets of a pension scheme could not be a special investment fund where the members of the scheme do not bear the risk arising from the management of the fund. So the question is, therefore, would the court's judgment have been any different in the case of a defined contribution pension scheme where the members do carry an investment risk? And this leads us on to ATP Pension Service. And in that case, the court ruled that a defined contribution pension scheme should be treated on par with other special investment funds for the purposes of that exemption. The court held that a pension fund could fall to treat as a SIF where they are funded by the persons to whom the retirement benefit is to be paid. The savings are invested using a risk-spreading principle, and most importantly, the pension customers bear the investment risk. So clearly here it was the bearing of investment risk that was crucial, and it's how a DC scheme was able to qualify as a special investment fund. Now in response, certainly Ireland has changed its laws to ensure that DC pension schemes now qualify as this. So far we've looked at portfolios of transferable securities. So the question is, and the question in Fiscale Einhead, is whether a company investing exclusively in property can be characterised as a SIF. And the opinion of the Advocate General, not yet the full court, but the Advocate General says yes. A company set up by more than one investor for the sole purpose of investing the assets assembled in an immovable property may be regarded as a special investment fund if the member state in question has subjected the company to specific supervision. So therefore, an authorised and regulated investment undertaking with a property portfolio can be regarded as a special investment fund. But this is another example of the court restricting the member state's discretion to determine what qualifies as a special investment fund, if that fund now has to be supervised. But in that case, we await the judgment of the court. Next slide, please. So we may have an authorised and regulated undertaking that is a SIF, but what actually constitutes management? In Deutsche Bank, the court did not have to opine on this, as the investment undertaking itself was not a SIF. So now it's back to Abbey National. And you'll remember in Abbey National, the concept of management of special investment funds, according to the court, had its own independent meaning in community law, whose content the member states may not alter. So the courts have already told us that the discretion within that law doesn't apply to the concept of management. It has its own EU-wide meaning. So therefore, member state discretion is only as to what regards the meaning of a special investment fund. So nonetheless, in Abbey National, whilst we have an EU-wide definition of management, the court did assist that EU-wide definition by reference to the UCITS Directive 85611, for details of the functions included in that activity of collective portfolio. So we have to have reference to Annex 2 of the directive, which lists three such functions. The first is investment management. The second is administration, which itself has nine separate sub-functions, such as legal and fund management, accounting services, customer inquiries, valuation and pricing, and six others. And the third function is marketing. But looking at Annex 2, the court in Abbey National took the view that Annex 2 did not cover the functions of a depository of undertakings for collective investment. And as those functions did not fall under management of effective investment, but under the control and supervision of their activities, the aim being to ensure that undertakings for collective investment are managed in accordance with law. Depository, now stroke trustee services, when supplied as a standalone service, are now deemed by the court not to fall within the term management, and so we're now seeing VAT charged on depository trustee services. So while confirming that a defined contribution pension scheme should be treated on par with other special investment funds for the purposes of that exemption, in ATP, the court also went on to set out a potentially wide-ranging interpretation of the services which can constitute the management of a special investment fund, including registration and reporting functions, opening of accounts, provision of facilities for the handling of payments, crediting contributions to customers' accounts, processing data and recording and missing payments, and issuing account statements. Now, this expansion of the scope of management is somewhat overlooked, as the focus in this case was on the judgment confirming that a DC scheme was a special investment fund, but the court did also opine on what could constitute management. And this leads us on to the principal case where management was actually addressed by the court, that's GFBK. And GFBK concerned the VAT treatment of advisory services provided to a self-managed investment undertaking. You will recall that Abbey National referenced the functions within Annex 2 as comprising a collective portfolio management, but here the court held that the fact that advisory and information services were not listed in Annex 2 did not preclude their inclusion in the category of specific services following the same activities for management of a special investment fund. Annex 2, according to the court, was not exhaustive. So the court held that in such a scenario, it's necessary to examine whether the services provided by a third party concerning investment in transferable securities are intrinsically connected to the activity characteristic of the fund so that they have the effect of performing the specific and essential functions of management of a special investment fund. So the court held that giving recommendations to purchase and sell assets are intrinsically connected to the activity characteristic of the undertaking, which consists in the collective investment in transferable securities of capital raised from the public. So consequently, in that case, the advisory services were exempt from that. Now, of course, in GFBK and in other EU cases, the court consistently restates that exemptions are exceptions to the general rule, and so are to be interpreted and applied narrowly. In ATP, but to a greater extent in GFBK, the court has widened the range of services within the term management, and the test is now whether, having established that the management is in respect of a special investment fund, as per Deutsche Bank, the services provided have the effect of performing the specific and essential functions of management of a special investment fund. If so, those services will be exempt from VAT. So okay, in GFBK, advisory services were part of the management function and VAT exempt, but what else could be in there? Could we have risk management, research, data analytics? We don't know, because we are waiting on member states now to give us their interpretation of GFBK and the range of services that could now fall within the term management with respect to exemption. But again, GFBK, whilst widening the range of management services typically provided to an investment portfolio within transferable securities, but what about an investment portfolio with assets consisting of real estate, so not necessarily transferable securities? So this brings us back to Fiscal Eilhead. Again, you recall that the Advocate General confirmed that an authorised and regulated investment undertaking with a property portfolio can be regarded as a special investment fund. But would the term management, for the purposes of VAT law, cover the actual management of the company's immovable property? In the Advocate General's opinion, the answer is yes. The management of such an investment fund under VAT law also covers the actual exploitation of the immovable property. So the question is, does this now mean that managers of a property owned by a fund provide VAT-exempt management services? Does this extend to rental invoicing and collection, liaising with tenants, security, refuse, collection, repairs and maintenance? Does this now mean that property managers could be VAT exempt and therefore have an unplanned VAT cost? Now, we are still waiting the judgment of the court in this case, but it's quite possible that the court will leave it to the member state to define what actually falls within the term of property management. So what we've seen is the European Court certainly conceding that member states have the discretion to determine what constitutes a special investment fund, but reining in the exercise of that discretion to ensure that member states first looks at the investment objectives and structure to ensure that it is a special investment fund, asks if it's supervised by the state, and the member state itself must adhere to the objective pursued by that law, and be conscious of competing investment undertakings and not discriminate between such competing undertakings. So while the discretion does not extend to what falls within the term management, as this is an EU-wide term, what we now have is the European Court exercising its discretion to determine what constitutes management, and so widen the range of services falling within that term. So with that, I hand you back.
Thank you very much, Richard. We now arrive to our last section, base erosion and profit shifting. Well, as today's Link and Learn is focused on the investment management industry and the tax updates, we will only talk about the updates on Action 6, which is the one that most impacts the investment funds. On the 22nd May 2015, the OECD, as part of its work on the action to address BEPS, released a revised discussion draft on Action 6 in relation to preventing the granting of treaty benefits in inappropriate circumstances. As with other discussion drafts on BEPS actions, the proposals do not represent a consensus view from the G20 and the OECD governments involved. The main proposals of the 22nd May draft paper are the following: limitation on benefits rule, publicly traded entities, discretionary relief, intermediate owners, derivative benefits and active business, funds, pension funds and other non-CIV funds, and the principal purpose test. One of the key discussions that for us it's interesting for the investment management is whether the LOB clause, the limitation on benefits, the LOB clause should apply and how to CIVs and non-CIVs. So how it should apply to collective investment vehicles and non-collective investment vehicles. On what concerns the impact on CIVs, the policy considerations behind the treatment of CIVs under the tax treaties has been an area of focus for the working party, specifically the application of the LOB clause to CIVs, taking into account the approach suggested by the 2010 OECD report, the granting of treaty relief, treaty benefits with respect to the income of collective investment vehicles, and advances since 2010, in particular, the results of the work on the treaty relief and compliance enhancement project called the TRACE document. Following comments received and discussions at the March 2015 meeting, the Working Party has concluded that the conclusions of the 2010 report remain relevant and that LOB proposals incorporate these recommendations. Therefore, no additional changes to the report on Action 6 are required to address these issues. However, the discussion paper notes that the implementation of the recommendations of the TRACE project is important in relation to the practical application of these conclusions. So, what is the Deloitte's approach in regards to the impact of the CIVs? Is the amendment of the LOB clause in order to include CIVs as qualified residents. In terms of the impact for non-CIVs, the report acknowledged that further work is required in respect to the policy considerations relating to non-CIV funds, such as REITs, sovereign wealth funds, pension funds, and alternative funds, such as private equity funds. The Working Party recognizes the economic importance of these funds and the need to grant treaty benefits where appropriate, but did not consider that most comments received took sufficient account of the treaty shopping concerns. The working party agreed that pension funds should be considered to be a resident of the state in which they are constituted, regardless of whether they benefit from a limited or complete exemption from taxation in that state. Commentators had suggested the removal of all restrictions on the residence of beneficiaries of a pension fund, specifically to counteract concerns surrounding EU law. The Working Party has concluded that removing all restrictions would raise treaty shopping concerns, especially as substantial foreign participation in a pension fund already is permitted. The proposal is that pension funds where 90% of beneficiaries are resident in either contracting state or are residents of a third state, if those individuals are entitled to the benefits of a treaty between the source state and the third state, and would be subject to the same or lower rate of tax on dividend or interest, also should qualify. It is recognized that work on non-CIV funds could continue after September 2015, but should be completed before December 2016. With this, I arrive to our conclusion to say that we have seen many tax developments over 2014 and 2015. The spotlight clearly goes to FATCA CRS. We are waiting for the final proposals on the BEP initiatives on the 5th of October, so that will be next week, and the continuous changes in local taxations, what I've mentioned before on capital gains taxation. We expect the end of this year to be full of tax news, and we anticipate already a very interesting 2016. And with this, we are now arriving towards the end of our presentation. We were very happy to share with you these insights on the topic of investment management tax updates. Should you wish to, you will be able to have access to a recorded version of this discussion 24 hours after the session via the link provided in your email invitation. We hope that you have appreciated this webinar and that we will have the occasion to meet again online during forthcoming sessions. Our next Link and Learn will be Market Abuse Directive 2 on the 15th of October of this year. Thank you very much and have a nice afternoon.